In this inaugural episode, we tackle one of the most important upheavals in physics, the notion that gravity isn't really a force at all. It's geometry. Yep, geometry. The same subject that haunted us in high school, except now it holds the secrets of planetary orbits, falling apples, and yes, the subtle influences behind your GPS. We'll start by tracing how Einstein came to challenge Newton, get a sneak peek at why curved space-time is much more than a random sci-fi phrase, and uncover everyday examples that prove you're living in a geometric wonderland, right now, whether you realize it or not. By the end, I'll leave you with a mind-boggling cliffhanger about time itself. Ready? Let's roll. Gravity is the quiet choreographer behind every step we take, every leaf that drifts to the ground, and every planet that circles a star. It's so woven into the fabric of our daily lives that we scarcely notice its presence. Yet it underlies the shape, motion, and destiny of everything from galaxies to coffee cups. Let's begin our tale in the late 17th century with the man of the hour, Sir Isaac Newton. He was the rock star of physics long before the term rock star existed. Newton's law of universal gravitation came from his insight that the same force pulling an apple toward the Earth also keeps the moon orbiting above us. This concept was radical in 17th century, and it gave humanity its first unifying law that described both earthly and celestial motion. Newton's equation for gravitational force is elegant. The force between two masses is proportional to the product of those masses and inversely proportional to the square of their distance. For centuries, he was revered as the greatest mind in science. But for all the genius behind Newton's law, it was incomplete. It worked beautifully for most everyday phenomena, but by the early 1900s, scientists were picking up on tiny discrepancies that Newton's framework couldn't fully explain. The orbit of Mercury, for one, kept playing hard to get with Newton's predictions. Over time, these small cracks hinted that maybe the universal force wasn't so universal after all. In 1905, a young Albert Einstein was working in a Swiss patent office, but also tinkering with ideas that would reshape physics. It was this year when he wrote four groundbreaking papers in one miracle year. But the real fireworks came a decade later in 1915, when Einstein published his theory of general relativity, revealing that gravity wasn't a mysterious force pulling objects. It was the result of curved space-time. For over 200 years, Newton's story of gravity had been the sacred text. And now someone comes along and says, that invisible force? Actually, it's not a force at all. But Einstein had conviction. His new equations perfectly explained Mercury's funny orbit. And soon, scientists sought more ways to test this radical new viewpoint. That sets the stage for our topic today. How Einstein's theory reframed gravity as geometry itself. Before we can tackle Einstein's grand view of gravity, we have to rewind a few years to the groundwork he laid in 1905 with special relativity, because that's where the concept of space-time was first crystallized. In the late 19th century, physicists wrestled with electromagnetism and the perplexing discovery that light's speed was constant for all observers, no matter how fast they were moving. Picture yourself in a spaceship racing toward a beam of light. You might expect that light would approach you faster than if you were standing still. Yet experiments such as Michelson-Morley ether experiment and Maxwell's equations revealed that no matter what you do, light still blazes along at about 300,000 kilometers per second. No more, no less. This baffling fact led Einstein to propose two radical postulates in special relativity. First, the laws of physics are the same in all inertial frames. That is, if you're moving at a constant velocity, the usual physics still applies. And second, the speed of light in a vacuum is constant for all observers. Those simple statements forced us to abandon the idea of absolute time and absolute rest. Instead, each observer measures distance and time based on their relative motion, which can differ from someone else's measurement. From these postulates arose the phenomenon of time dilation. If you're traveling at speeds close to light, your clock will tick more slowly compared to someone who's standing still. Meanwhile, your spaceship might see the other person's clock slow down from your vantage point. Relativity is symmetrical in that way. This mutual time dilation is mind-boggling, but repeated experiments, like flying atomic clocks around the world, have confirmed it. Another outcome is length contraction, along the direction of motion. Distances shrink for the moving observer. If you're zipping near light speed, a 100-meter stretch of road might appear to be only 50 meters. Even more bizarre, events that happen simultaneously for one person could occur at different times for another. This is known as the relativity of simultaneity. So how do we make sense of this new world without absolute time? The short answer is that space and time aren't separate at all. They're two threads woven into one seamless fabric we call space-time. Picture it like this. Instead of having a big room called space with a giant universal clock somewhere else, Einstein realized those ideas had to merge. Three dimensions of space and one dimension of time all blend into a single four-dimensional stage where events play out. When you move, you're actually traveling through both space and time, and someone else moving at a different speed or direction might split those four dimensions differently. That's why each observer ends up with their own perspective on what's simultaneous or how long something lasts. No one gets the final say on an absolute timeline. There isn't one. It all depends on your motion. This four-dimensional viewpoint also keeps the speed of light consistent for everyone, which is what experiments demanded. Since space and time are just aspects of the same fabric, any change in one affects the other, ensuring light's speed never wavers. In everyday life, these differences are small. But when we talk about high speeds or strong gravity, the effects become dramatic. Clocks can slow down, lengths can shrink, and events you thought happened together may not be simultaneous for someone else. In short, space-time is our new backdrop, a single unified way to think about distance, duration, and motion, all at once. Special relativity handed us this surprising revelation, and it transformed the question of gravity from what force pulls objects into how does mass reshape the geometry we all move through. That's where general relativity steps in. We can think of each observer as moving on a personal world line through space-time. Their notion of now, past, and future depends on their motion. Minkowski, one of Einstein's contemporaries, famously said, "Henceforth, space by itself and time by itself are doomed to fade away into mere shadows, and only a kind of union of the two will preserve an independent reality." But special relativity has a boundary. It handles situations where observers are moving at constant speeds or are far from gravitational influences. The moment we introduce acceleration or significant masses like stars, planets, or black holes, special relativity doesn't have the final word. After all, special means it's limited to inertial frames only. The second you have to deal with a rocket blasting off or you're standing on Earth's surface feeling pulled downward, you're no longer in an inertial frame. Einstein realized that a deeper theory was needed to handle acceleration and gravity. One of the first major hints that something was wrong with the classic physics view of gravity came from the orbit of Mercury, which refused to follow Newton's laws to the letter. its closest point to the sun, the perihelion, kept shifting slightly more than predicted by classical equations. Astronomers tried to patch this by inventing a hidden planet named Vulcan or by tweaking Newton's formulas, but none of that stuck. Similar, small discrepancies appeared in the moon's orbit around Earth, and efforts to unite gravity with the then-emerging field of electromagnetism were fraught with contradictions. By the early 1900s, these clues had piled up enough to suggest that gravity, as Newton defined it, needed a deeper explanation. By 1907, Einstein had begun wondering, what if gravity and acceleration are actually the same phenomenon at heart? This led him to the equivalence principle, the idea that free fall under gravity is indistinguishable from inertial motion in empty space. If you're in a tiny elevator, you can't tell whether you're being pulled down by gravity or accelerating upward. That insight cracked open the door to general relativity, where the geometry of space-time itself would play the starring role. In essence, special relativity tells us that time and space flex with motion, but it stays silent on what happens when mass and gravity enter the scene. That's where general relativity comes in. Einstein set out to describe not just how objects move when traveling at high speeds, but also how they move when massive bodies warp the fabric of space-time. The result would turn our notion of forces upside down. If this introduction to special relativity feels fast, don't worry. Check out our series dedicated to special relativity, where we go deep into the wonders of Einstein's genius. So, to understand how Einstein defined gravity as geometry, picture a large, stretchy trampoline. Imagine that the trampoline's surface represents the fabric of space-time, when nothing massive is around, so it's perfectly flat and at rest. Place a bowling ball in the middle and watch the fabric sag. That bowling ball stands for an object with mass, like a planet or a star, causing the once flat surface to bend under its weight. Now, roll a marble across that sheet, it curves around the bowling ball. Well, the marble wants to move straight ahead, but the sheet beneath it is no longer flat. It slopes downward toward the bowling ball, so the marble's straight path in this curved environment ends up looping around. If you were to look at it from above, you'd see the marble tracing what appears to be a curve, almost like it's being pulled by some force. We tend to say the marble is attracted by a force, but you can see there's no actual pulling hand here. Instead, the marble's just following a straight line in this newly curved surface, what physicists call a geodesic. In other words, there's no invisible pull, it's simply traveling along the curved path in the stretched fabric. This captures the essence of Einstein's insight. Mass changes the geometry of space-time around it, and any smaller object naturally follows that geometry. You might remember from school geometry class that the shortest distance between two points on a flat surface is a straight line. On a sphere, however, like Earth, the shortest route between two cities is along a great circle. We call that the sphere's geodesic. According to Einstein, when you see a planet orbiting a star, it's not spinning around from some force. The planet is traveling on a geodesic in 4D space-time. Because that space-time is curved around the star, the path loops around. In 3D, it looks like a circle or ellipse. In 4D, it's a straight shot. To take Newton's example, the apple falls not because of an invisible hand, but because it moves along the local geodesic, which plunges it toward Earth's surface. Before we sign off, I have to warn you about an even weirder twist. This geometry doesn't just affect the space part. Time itself gets tangled in it. Have you ever wondered if your watch and someone else's watch can tick differently, purely because of where you stand on Earth? Yep, that's the real next chapter. This revelation leads to gravitational time dilation, the phenomenon that deeper in a gravitational well, clocks run slower compared to those far away. It's not science fiction. It's built into your phone's GPS and confirmed by countless experiments. Imagine living at sea level, where gravity is slightly stronger, versus living atop a mountain where it's slightly weaker. The difference is small, but measurable. We'll unveil those paradoxes in our next episode. Tune in and we'll dive deeper into the cosmic rabbit hole.